It's April 2020, the world has lost its mind, and everyone and their grandmother's stuck inside some hour-long Zoom meeting that they never wanted to be a part of in the first place. I'm not sure why Zoom, of all the other video sharing apps, just happened to take a hold of the zeitgeist, at least in the West, and everyone just started using it like crazy. F's in the chat for Skype. But the Zoom UX I've always found to be, as you can see here, not really that great. I never really understood why it was that they just took off like they did, because I find it clunky, hard to use, and just a little bit weird. So we're going to fix that today. We're going to take Zoom and turn it into what I think it could have been. Now, I just want to start by saying that I don't really have a good business case for redesigning Zoom. If Zoom was to approach me after they see how viral this video went and ask me to come in and redesign their product, I would probably tell them no. And that's because there's not really much business value to them in making their UX really, really clean and easy to use. They're already the market leader. They've got the brand. Why? What would a new UX do for them, right? It's really a risk mitigation strategy. You don't want some hoity-toity competitor to come flying out of nowhere and just say, hey, we're video communication that's actually easy to use, right? But the risk of that's quite low, so I don't imagine it being a huge issue for them. But nonetheless, for the content, we're gonna redo Zoom. So anyway, here we are again in Figma. Got some sexy little brand guidelines here. Again, this is taken straight from their website, and here we've got the standard Zoom blue, a couple of accent colors. Their secondary is kind of an orange feel. And then we've got some standard black hues. Their font is Lato, the Google font. They're using that for the header and the body. Not ideal, but we'll work with that. And here, of course, is a little reference I've got for what a standard Zoom call looks like between two people. And we're just going to get in there and redesign it. We're going to design lots of different perspectives. But ultimately, there is a few things that I really want to make sure we cover, and that is user stories, right? So I've taken what I would imagine to be the main utility of Zoom and ranked it based on kind of the perceived importance to the user from just my assumptions. And of course, right at the top here, we've got communicate clearly and effectively with my colleagues, includes knowing who's talking and audio video issues, things like that. But then we've also got things like controlling my audio and making sure that they're plugged in correctly, sharing my screen, recording the meeting, etc., etc. So we've got a whole bunch of use cases here, and I'm going to translate them onto this screen here. So I'm going to get going, strap yourself in, and we'll see what we come up with. For the sake of time, I went ahead and created a little picture component that swaps between male and female photos, just like you were looking into a webcam here. But here I'm realizing that, much like the current Zoom experience, we kind of need a way to label who's talking, because you don't obviously recognize people's names, people's faces from their names. People are often meeting for the first time on Zoom, so that's what I'm doing here. Kind of a no-brainer here, but on any kind of video communication platform like this, you really have to show the user their perspective. This is what you look like on camera right now. I've had many an interesting situation where there's been like some food on my face, and it just saves so many awkward social interactions. One thing that I thought was missing from Zoom was the ability to mute or remove a user or just interact with a user by hovering over their video feed. Right now, you kind of have to do everything from the participants panel, so I'm adding in context, mute, and other options here. Here I'm creating the controls for muting your mic, your camera, everything you'd expect to be able to do on a video communication platform, and I just can't stress how intuitive and easy it is to use the Figma components these days. If you really want to be serious about design, you got to learn how components work, because I'm just saving myself boatloads of time by creating just one component and then just swapping out variants for different icons and keeping everything else the same. You'll see I chose to deviate from the standard black, the primary black they had, with a much darker black here. And that's intentional, to give it some distinction between the background. And oftentimes, I think companies don't have enough blacks and grays in their color palette, which really limits your design capabilities. So always good to have a handful of them in your back pocket. Something else that I found frustrating as a Zoom host is just the fact that they don't have some way for me to quickly, at a glance, figure out if there's any sort of issues with my connection, my microphone, my speakers, or the camera. Oftentimes, if there's a connection blip, or if there's some kind of stutter in another participant's video, I want to be able to just glance at something really quick and make sure that all systems are operational. So that's what this is here. And my intent was that this little widget in the lower left would also allow users to connect their camera and their microphone at the very start of joining a particular meeting. Since this is the place for status information about a call, it made sense to include a recording notification there as well. But since that's a little bit different from the general status of the call, I wanted to separate it with a little divider and give it its own space. Something that you can do to boost the usability of your design work is to place controls intuitively next to other parts of the UI that are related to them. So this invite people button is right next to the control that shows the participants list. It's intuitive to the user, they expect it to be there, and it saves them a bunch of time. From a user's perspective, if I activate the chat, I don't want it to occlude the video because, again, the main purpose here is to communicate effectively with another human. And if I'm opening the chat to send them a link or something, I still want to look at them to maintain eye contact and just pick up on all the social cues that are there. So just adding that to the sidebar here and rearranging everything in the UI so that it makes more sense. Sometimes Figma's auto layout just doesn't cut it and you need to add a little spacer element to flesh out the layout and have things line up perfectly. There's nothing wrong with that. It's very normal. It's another tool in your arsenal. I know this seems kind of trivial, but I've found that whenever you're trying to label something that has a specific number of children and you need the user to know how many children there are, your intuition is just to go 3 participants or 3x. But from a user's perspective, you kind of just want to know what the contents are. And that's more important than the number generally. So you want to put you want to describe the contents first and then put the number to the side of it in its own little dedicated space like I'm doing here for participants. And in classic demystifying design fashion, just spending the last few minutes of this totally neurotically measuring things out so that they all look clean in prototype tool. All right, there we go. Like I mentioned at the start, Zoom is more or less relatively easy to use. There's just a couple UX hangups, and I think we can now confidently go through and check this final story here, because that's kind of a compound story. Users can now communicate clearly, efficiently with their colleagues using this interface. So here's the final result we've got, and ultimately nothing really crazy has been changed. I've just rearranged things and used alignment and color to kind of draw your attention to the things that matter the most, which is really the person you're talking to, right? The other face, the other human in the experience. And then all the other controls are very highly subdued away. The ones that are important are just kind of monitoring your connection, microphone, camera, and sound, making sure that's all ready to go. Obvious controls for turning on and off your camera and your microphone, monitoring your actual video feed yourself, and then, you know, clicking through the experience to interact with other users or jump into the participants and control the meeting a little more from there by inviting people. So again, that's it. Let me know what you think specifically, because this one is a little bit of a controversial one. A lot of people have very specific opinions on how the Zoom UX works. And if you do happen to find a product experience that you find particularly clunky or hard to use, please do leave it in a comment. I'm slowly running out of ideas, and I'm grasping at straws, as you can tell here. But I hope you found this one useful, and have a wonderful day, folks. Take care.